I'm Jacob.
I'm Yuri.
And we're going for a drive.
T20 Alfa Romeo Giulia.
Quadrifoglio without launch control though. Brake boost. Okay, that was pretty good, but it made a lot of crazy sounds.
Horsepower and torque.
505 horsepower, 443 pound-feet of torque from a Ferrari-derived twin-turbo 2.9 liter V6.
And does it sound good?
It sounds really good, but it's a little bit quiet.
So I find when you're fully ripping it, it doesn't sound that good. Mostly when you're going at slower speeds and then shifting not fully, then it's the best.
So I'm gonna give it 3/4 throttle and shift it about 5,000 right now. Let's see if I can get it. A little bit, yeah.
You get that grr. And when you get the windows down, you're rolling through a nice quiet neighborhood, totally ruining everyone's day or making all the Ferrari fans very happy.
I think you really are, because this thing is gorgeous. So we do have a lot to talk about. This is a 2020 and there's been a lot of updates, mostly to the interior though. And you guys have been asking us to review the Alfa Romeo Giulia Quadrifoglio for so long. We've been asking to get one as well. We couldn't get one, but now that we're over 1 million subscribers, we finally got one.
Getting to 1 million subscribers has really helped for getting more opportunities and getting cooler cars. So we've got some extra cool stuff coming up because of that. So if you feel like subscribing, it'll definitely help for more cool cars in the future.
It's already helped with this, so consider subscribing. Thank you.
And previously, we have only driven the Stelvio Quadrifoglio, which I absolutely loved. But spoiler alert, I think I like that one a little more than this.
I like the looks of this more, but let's get into what this car is now.
So have they changed anything with the drivetrain?
Absolutely not.
Nice.
Exactly. So it still sounds really good, like we said, but it's just not as loud as the Stelvio felt like, or maybe we're just remembering it differently.
I'm pretty sure the Stelvio was better sounding. I don't know.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Like, this feels like it's just missing something. Like, it sounds way better from the outside, and let's see how it is sending it through cliche corner. Okay. Oh my God. Okay, so this thing is not a handful. It's so tossable. It's so nimble. Like, this car feels like it's so small.
And it is rear wheel drive.
Yes, and it hides its weight really well. It does have an ELSD in the back, and I think it is actually working pretty well.
And how did you feel shifting the column mounted paddles through cliche?
Okay, couple things. Number one, they feel amazing. Number two, they do feel more exotic because they are column mounted, as we always say. Number three, this thing automatically upshifts for you unless you're in race mode.
But that kind of makes sense because race mode is for racing. And the cool thing about race mode is if you're in drive, it'll tell you to put it into manual for a better experience.
Yeah, I love that about this. But this is an 8-speed ZF auto and it does shift really quickly, even faster once you put it in race mode. And I have been driving this in race mode pretty much the entire time because I don't find it too stiff. It's definitely a stiff car. The suspension is definitely sports car-like or sports sedan-like. And we do have the ability to actually change the damping of the suspension by just pressing a button. We don't actually have a custom mode and we don't have any exhaust valves because they're tied to the drivetrain modes.
But new on this year, you could actually have the open exhaust valves in D mode.
Yeah, which is really nice because when you're in race mode, traction is off and there's no way to turn it back on because traction is tied to each drive mode.
There is no traction button. We checked the manual. You type in traction, it's like traction mode error and that's it. Same with launch control. Couldn't find anything about launch control in there, and then Jacob did a quick Google search and it was just a bunch of people on forums not knowing what they were talking about.
Okay, whoever's on these Alfa Romeo forums saying this has like line lock and launch control, you're all wrong. This doesn't have any of that stuff.
No, it's just car.
Yeah, exactly. Like, so you brake boost it and it will do a bit of a burnout as I did when I launched it, but that's it.
I think that's what they think line lock was just straight up doing a burnout.
Yes, exactly. Yes, it does lock the front calipers, but the back ones are also locked, but there's just more power back there. And we do have torque vectoring and it changes between the drive modes, so you can actually see it in your drive mode explorer now. So when you're in race mode, the torque vectoring is in drift. And I would love to be able to drift this one day.
Yeah, this feels like it can be very drifty, but it's not as drifty as like the C63 was.
You're right about that, and I can explain exactly why. This takes a little bit of time to build boost. So as you're flooring it into a corner, you have to wait for the turbos to spool up, and then it sends the back end all the way around.
I guess kind of like 80s 911 turbo style that everyone was scared of.
A little bit. Like, there is that sense of it, which gives a character, which is kind of cool. But I have to say that it does have some lag.
And then I guess also trying to slide it around with column-mounted paddles is confusing if you're not used to it, because you're like, yeah, I'll just just shift while my hands are here, and then you actually just downshifted with your right hand?
Yeah, and yes, you shouldn't be shifting while you're drifting, but that's a different story. But this feels way more tossable than the C63 does. This just feels like a smaller car, even though that was a coupe that we drove.
Which would probably be the exact same size as this as a coupe if they ever decided to make one.
Yes, because this competes with the M3 and stuff like that. So we touched on these drive modes. Yuri, what does DNA mean?
So marketing be marketing got to it. D stands for dynamic, N stands for natural, and A is advanced efficiency.
It does make sense, and it's kind of Maserati-ish because they had the ICE mode.
Yeah, increased control and efficiency.
Yeah, so I get it.
And they are part of the same FCA company.
That's right, so this is a Chrysler at the end of the day, just like a Maserati is as well.
Which we're gonna get into when we talk about the infotainment.
Oh my God, look at those window switches, straight out of a Dodge Charger.
Ah, I hate it, this is the worst.
So I'm gonna floor it in N mode just so we can hear it. Pretty quiet. Now I'm gonna go to D mode. Way better.
I love the sound of this car. I just think it needs to be amplified a bit because it's got such a cool tone, no fake pops, no fake crackles, no fake nothing. It just needs to be a little louder, and I don't like exhausts on cars. I know this is straight pipes.
Yeah.
I don't like aftermarket exhausts.
I'm the one that loves the loud exhausts.
But this needs that.
This needs to be straight piped. Like it really does.
I don't know about straight pipe.
Yes, it does.
Maybe just a nicer exhaust. Maybe you just need to spend more time outside of the Alfa Romeo, because it sounds amazing out here.
And on the GTA M.
GTA M, where M stands for Modificata.
Which we don't get in North America, and we probably won't. It comes with an Akrapovich exhaust.
But now I'm a little worried, because in that GTA M virtual review we did, we said we would take the GTA M over the Project 8. After hearing this in person, like, I'm a little nervous. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I like a lot more about this, especially in the looks department, than the Jaguar Project 8.
But sound and power, I think.
Yeah.
I might win. Yeah. Anyways.
And you do love your V6s, so that says a lot about how this sounds right now.
I love six cylinders in general.
True, yes.
Give me an inline, I'm good.
Yeah, but you like a lot of V6s. Like, you like the VQ
and stuff. As long as there's six cylinders.
Yes.
I like the sound.
I get it. So let's get into the looks, because I think this thing is gorgeous.
Italian design, you know I like that.
And so do I. So let's start with the front end. We have the traditional Alfa front grille.
And since they imported this baby from Michigan because we couldn't get one in Canada, we are running sans front plates.
You know what this is, right? This is imported from Detroit. This is Eminem.
Exactly. So then we've also got the same old Alfa Romeo headlights at the front, which are kind of Maserati-ish, where they're just kind of like a little bit of a line poking out.
Yeah, they look pretty good, but they're nothing too crazy. Overall, the front end just looks really good.
Yeah, lots of real grills, and we got that cool triangle grill in the front, and then we got a really cool hood as well.
Yeah, and those vents are real, and it is a carbon fiber hood, and underneath that hood is that Ferrari-derived V6, and it looks pretty cool.
But not as cool as the Maseratis did.
I totally agree. And moving on to the side, we have the Quadrifoglio badge on the front fenders.
Or as I like to mistakenly call it, Quadrifoglio.
Yes, which I'm sure a lot of North Americans probably say.
Wheels.
Love these wheels, and I think these are the better wheels because there is another optional wheel.
I like them a lot. I think I like them in a lighter color on the Stelvio more with the big yellow brake calipers, because we're not running yellows here.
But we do have the carbon ceramics on this, and they stop incredibly well. However, they are obviously very expensive. And then we also have a real vent on the front fender, and what do you think of the overall side profile?
I really love the body lines. I think it's kind of a waste to have it in white because it doesn't pop as much unless you're driving in the rain.
And this is actually an optional paint that you have to pay for as well.
Well, I mean, it does look nice.
It does, but like better in red.
Man, give me the red or give me the blue.
Exactly.
But overall side profile, it looks very good. And I know a lot of people complain about this pillar being up front. You complained about it too because you sit so far back because you're tall.
However, getting in and out, I basically use my shoulder against this, so it's kind of making it easier to get in and out.
And then how about moving on to the back end?
I love the back end. Look at those exhausts. That's the first thing I see.
Yeah, real, it's very cool. And then we've got a whole bunch of cool splitter wrapped around it that's like very, very aggressive.
And moving to the top of the trunk, we have a nice little lip spoiler as well.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. Subtle though, but it has got a cool shape to it.
And what do you think of these taillights?
The same thing I thought 4 years ago when this car first came out, because we're just getting it now.
Yeah, they didn't update the outside looks. They added some like blackout packages and carbon fiber packages, but that's about it.
Yeah, no, it looks nice. Totally solid look. I have nothing against this except for I don't like it in white.
And I think this is one of the best looking cars on the road, but let's get you into the driver's seat, maybe for a launch? That picks up nice.
Okay, it didn't really squeal off the line or anything. It pretty much just gripped right away.
Yeah, if you don't brake boost it, you'll get a pretty decent launch after the fact of the first couple feet.
then shifting it yourself is very nice. And we've got those cool shift lights up in the middle in race mode where it goes yellow on the side and then says shift. And I kind of want to see my gear there instead of my speed. It's hard to see your gear.
Yeah, I totally agree. Like, you really don't know what gear you're in. It's the smallest number.
Little push through cliche corner. I mean, it's pretty neutral if you're not like totally mashing it and trying to drift.
It really is. And how's the steering?
I don't want to say very direct, but it's very responsive.
It's probably the most direct steering I've experienced.
I just don't like saying that
word. I know. The direct word is like the worst word you can use.
Yeah, but like, it's like wherever you want to go, it goes. It's very easy, not weird at all.
The smallest input you give it, it actually gives you back.
So now let's get to the interior and some of the changes we have here.
Number one, the steering wheel is thicker now.
Slightly thicker. To be honest, I didn't notice much of a difference from the Stelvio, but I don't mind it at all. It's definitely not BMW thick.
No, and then we also have some carbon fiber and some silver trim as well.
Infotainment, that's the big one.
Yes, it is.
It's a whole new system. It has Apple CarPlay, it has Android Auto, and they're both widescreen.
And now it's a touchscreen as well, which it wasn't before. And overall, it's very functional. However, it's also very laggy.
Okay, so you can also control this rotary wheel as well as using it as a touchscreen, which I think is the perfect combination because in an electric car, I want to have a rotary wheel. But when you're going from mode to mode, like, it's not a smooth transition. It's like not something you'd get out of like a brand new Mercedes.
No, not even close.
But the fact is, this is still an FCA product. And Maserati used the good infotainment from Chrysler, like on the Jeeps and on the Challengers and stuff. And that has actual rewinding satellite radio stations and everything, where this only has live rewinding.
Yeah, I really don't think they should have spent the time or the money developing their own system from this. They should have just used the one that they put into every other FCA product that we like so much.
And then there's a couple weird things that you have to access through the infotainment, like to turn off and on your lane keep, it's like you gotta deep dive into the infotainment through one of the little widgets they have right there.
Yeah, because we do have a button for the lane keep assist, which is highway driving assist in this car, on the steering wheel. So let's get into highway driving assist and how incredible it is.
So this is the first Alfa Romeo with level 2 autonomy, but it's exactly the same system from the Maseratis, and we know that because when you get into the mode, it turns green exactly like the Maseratis in the gauges.
Yeah, so this thing will basically fully drive itself. It's level 2 autonomy. You basically just sit there and get teleported places as long as you have 2 points of contact on the steering wheel.
Spoiler alert, if you're wearing shorts and your knee is touching the wheel, that also works.
That is 2 points of contact.
I mean one.
Oh, you can do it with one knee. Interesting.
And then the gauges are analog gauges on the side and digital in the middle. We do have a little button on the end of the turnstock on the right that can go through different pages on your gauge cluster that you can customize in your infotainment based on your mode.
The right one is the wiper stock, but anyways, that's the button that I keep forgetting in Alphas.
And the turnstock sucks because it's like the old BMW style where if you turn it, you have to like unclick to unturn it, where it always just goes back to zero.
Yeah, like you have to cancel it in a weird way.
And then what else do we have new in this interior?
Well, if we look down at our center console, the shifter is all new, the shifter surround is all new, there's a lot more carbon fiber and a lot less plastic. Overall, it looks a lot more upscale and premium.
Definitely looks nicer.
And then we also have a key slot to the right of the shifter, which is a very fancy touch.
Yeah, and the key fits in there perfectly, and it's nice because you don't want to have too much stuff in your pocket, because these days, you got your mask, you got your sanitizer, house keys, car keys, wallet, phone.
There's a lot of stuff in pockets.
We need to bring back cargo shorts.
They left?
Well, not for John Cena, but for everyone else, yeah. John Cena. He's actually in the back right now. You can't see him.
Obviously. And what about these cup holders, Yuri?
Yeah, they fit a cup just fine.
All right. And what about the visors?
3, 2, 1.
Yes.
Full pass.
But...
yeah, it doesn't matter. Still full pass. It extends.
It just doesn't go very far.
And by the way, we've got the little left and right arrows here, and people have been sending me a ton of TikToks of people discovering that, but nobody's crediting us.
We invented that.
We invented the visor test.
Yes.
But not every visor extends, TikTokers.
No. Yeah, people are saying everyone does it. Nah.
Also, we don't have TikTok.
We do have an account so that people wouldn't steal it, but we don't use it. But make sure you guys follow us on Instagram at the Straight Pipes at Yuri Terrishin. And looking at the general interior, in this one we have the optional green and white stitching, which looks fantastic with this white exterior.
And all the red graphics in the infotainment, very Italian to me.
But then you can't get white and green stitching on a red interior.
I feel like that would be the best stitching option.
It'd be kind of interesting.
Okay, and then these seats. These are our first Alfa Romeo seats that aren't carbon fiber buckets.
Very comfortable, a lot less race car, but still very good.
We've got a lot of adjustable bolstering. It can move around a lot, good lumbar, like a big air bladder in the back. I feel like I kind of like the carbon fiber buckets more that we had in the Stelvio.
They were super cool.
Okay, and then how about back seat room?
Back seat room is not very good for someone of my stature at 6'1.5".
And at 5'8"-ish, it's just fine. And if we had to look back using our reverse camera, it is kind of low res, it is kind of dark. Not as good as I think it should be for a brand new infotainment.
Yeah, there's no 360 camera and it's a very terrible resolution. And generally looking at this interior, I think it looks really good with all this carbon fiber, white. The materials are pretty decent, everything's pretty pretty soft.
And then having the start stop button on the steering wheel with the carbon fiber there and the little clover, like, it's a very nice touch. Inside here is amazing.
And one of the cool touches to the infotainment and interior is that we have wireless charging, and when you drop your phone in this little slot, it says wireless charging enabled on the infotainment, so you don't have to look at your stupid phone.
Okay, I have a complaint about that.
I'm sure you do.
When your phone is plugged in for Apple CarPlay, I drop it in this wireless thing and it's like, oh, something's in here that shouldn't be in here, and then it's got like a timer and a long warning. It's like, yeah, I know my phone's there. Like, I don't need a warning every time that lasts for like 10 seconds.
So when I have my Android Auto plugged in, it says wireless charging enabled, even though it's already plugged in. So I'm getting twice the charge, obviously.
I don't know if that's how it works.
No.
So I feel like that's everything with the Alfa Romeo Giulia Quadrifoglio. Let's get to the price.
A lot of money, obviously. $90,945 to start.
Canadian.
And this one is sitting at $109,435.
Kind of what I expect for something like this. That's a luxury Italian.
But if you delete the carbon ceramic brake calipers and a couple other things in here, you can get this under 100 grand.
I like it a lot. I think it sounds great. It needs to be louder. For some reason, I don't like it as much as the Stelvio. I feel like that was just better.
I know what you're talking about with the exhaust and the feeling we got from it, but I really like this.
Yeah, I really like it as well, but I feel like it's just missing a little bit more. And the upgrades they did to the infotainment, I don't think they did a good enough job. But I'm very happy with the lane keep assist, the level 2 autonomy. I think that's like a huge selling feature for this, unless your traffic jam commute is on a farm road that's not a registered highway, because then it won't work.
However, comparing this to a C63 or an M3, I would take this, even though I think it's technically a worse vehicle objectively, but I'm more attached to this. I think this is just cooler.
Unless I can get the C63 in a 2-door, then I would take that over this, I think.
But you can't, because it's not a 2-door. But you've got to compete for the sedans.
Kind of compete with the price.
No.
And this class.
No. So let us know what you guys think of the Alfa Romeo Giulia Quadrifoglio, and would you pick it over its competition?
And should we find a way to get Italy to send us the GTA Modificato?
I'd even take just the GTA.
No, it's got to be the Modificato.
Modificato.
Oh, sorry.
Who knows what it's called? And check out this video of the Alfa Romeo Stelvio Quadrifoglio to see everything that we were talking about earlier. Click that right there.
I gotta take that over this.
I wouldn't on my bicycle on it.
That was all-wheel drive, rear-wheel drive, and my bicycle.